Greetings and welcome back. In this video, I want to give you a high-level overview of Cascade. I'm not going to go over each and every single button, knob, switch, and dial. If you do want that, I recommend you check out our documentation over the Cascade Particle Editor. This actually does go over each and every button and tells you what all the things do, so definitely check that out if you're super curious. My goal here is to just kind of give you a high-level rundown so that you know generally what you're looking at and where to find the things that you need. So at the very top, you have a menu bar, and given the options that are available in the toolbar, you're probably never going to use it, so we'll just jump right on past to the toolbar. Now, the toolbar from left to right, so you have some save functions. You have restart simulation. That'll restart it either here or in the level. So if you make changes and you don't notice those changes update in your levels, make sure you hit restart level. Of course, undo redo. You can save out the thumbnail. You can also show a few different things that are very useful. You can see the bounds of the particle system. That's super useful, particularly with GPU particle systems, because if you don't have a fixed set of bounds, then it's very difficult to control when GPU particles render. That's something we'll talk about a little bit later when you create a GPU particle system. For now, it's just important to know that you can turn those on and off. You can show and hide the origin axis for the effect. You can also change the background color, so not all particle systems look all that great against black. In fact, the smoke here looks a little bit weird. But if we start increasing the background color, it starts to become a little more apparent what all that stuff looks like. So be sure to play with that to get the overall feel of your particle system just right. Now, next to this, we have the LOD section. I'm not going to go into all of this right now because I'd like to have a separate discussion over what LODs are and how to work with them inside of Cascade. But the idea here is this is where you can go to create different LODs or levels of detail if you're unfamiliar with the term. And in brief, those are just different tiers of settings based on how far you are from the particle system. So the farther away you get, the more simple, the more basic the particle system can become. Now, down from here, we have the viewport. It's pretty straightforward what this is, right? It's just a place for you to preview your particle system. It navigates like all of the 3D viewports inside of Unreal, so you can hold down Alt and you can tumble around your particle system with the left mouse button, or you can drive with left mouse. You can left and right together to track, or right mouse to rotate. You got a view menu to turn on and off various things you might want to see. Of particular importance in here would be things like the particle counts, which are currently on at the moment, or things like particle memory to show you how much memory this particle system would take. You can also show and hide different things like vector fields if you're dealing with a GPU particle system, or you can preview what this particle system would look like in motion. And I've turned on motion and the particle system is actually moving around in a circle. Now, moving on from there, we have the time menu. The most important thing in here, I find, is just the ability to turn on and off real time as you may need to. So to the right, we have the emitter list. This shows all of the different emitters that make up our particle system. So in this case, we have a lot, actually. We have a couple called flames, we have some smoke, we have embers, sparks, and a heat shimmer for distortion. Now, keep in mind that when working with these emitters, you've got a lot of options here. You can right-click on any given emitter, and under the emitter submenu, you can delete, you can export an emitter into another particle system if you have two instances of Cascade open. You can duplicate an emitter. You can duplicate and share, which means that, say for instance, if I do that here, we get another copy of this emitter, and all of the modules are completely shared. So if I change one, it's the same as changing the other. But since we don't really need that, I'm going to go over to emitter and show you how the delete function works. And it's going to throw out a quick warning and say, are you sure you want to delete it? And we're going to say, absolutely, we want that gone. Now, one thing I do want to mention, this is a super important, not quite secret thing, but I'll be the first to stand up and say it's not the most discoverable thing ever. There are some settings that are inherent to an emitter itself. So this is just making quick mention of the details panel, which there's enough detailed panels in Unreal that hopefully you've been exposed to them at this point. It's just where you change your properties, but you might notice that as you click on different modules, your details panel is context sensitive and it's gonna change for the details that you see. If you click on an emitter, you'll see the settings for that emitter. If you click on a blank spot in the emitter list, you get the properties for the entire particle system, and that is a huge help, major trick, And it's not exactly a secret, but it's also one of those things that I want to make sure everybody gets to know about and everybody discovers. So keep in mind, if you click on a blank spot in the emitter list, like this empty area over here on the right-hand side, that gives you the properties for the entire particle system. Now, along with the emitters, there's some things you should know about. You have the ability to turn any emitter on and off with a check mark. You can solo an emitter, so if you just want to see that one and nothing else. You can also control how it renders. So if you click this once, you change the, and let me solo it, it'll be a little bit easier to see. So by clicking this the first time, I convert it over to points, or to crosses, or to lights, or I can just nullify it altogether. So there's some controls there for just how you see different things. And soloing is probably one of my favorite things when setting up an effect, right? If you want to make sure that your fire looks exactly right, you can just solo it out and get that perfected, and then start bringing in other effects as you need them. The details panel, pretty cut and dry. It's just like every other details panel out there. Of particular import is the search bar, because you can use that to find a particular property, because sometimes these lists of properties get pretty long. Also, if you're trying to figure out what you changed to, that made a particle system look bad or look good, or you know, how did I do that? Make sure you keep in mind that you can click on the little eye drop down here and show only the modified properties. Just also keep in mind that you will need to turn that back off if you suddenly look like you're missing some properties. Now, in the lower right-hand corner, you have the curve editor. This is huge and massive and important, and I can't stress how vital it is enough. So what I'm going to do real quick is I'm going to remove all the curves from it, which I can do with the right mouse button. And now it's completely empty. And let's send some curves over there. So I'm going to solo out the flames in this case, and we have a color over life module. And I can send the curves, or any curves associated with this module, down to the curve editor by clicking on this little tiny green curve button on the right-hand side of the module. So we'll click, and there you go. Now, we can't see the entire curve, so we can fit horizontally and vertically, and boom, now we can see those curves and how great they look. So let's hide out the alpha curve, because we don't necessarily need to see that. And here are the curves for red, green, and blue. So what I'd like to do is, let's see, let's just hit shift, and we'll click on one of the curves. I'm sorry, that's control click right here on one of the curves. And I will create a color just by arbitrarily moving these around. And you'll notice that now the fire is changing color midway through its life. Now that's certainly not the best color I could have possibly chosen. Let's do something that's a little more dominated by red. So we'll narrow down to only red, and we'll really drive red up, and then we can just show blue. You'll notice I'm clicking on these little squares for red, green, and blue to turn those on and off. Green, we can use a little bit of green because it'll start to give us a bit of a yellowish turn. And then for blue, let's see, in this case, if we crank it up, you'll see we're starting to get a little bit of shade of purple there. But if I pull that back down, that pulls that out, and now we're just kind of getting a little bit of yellow flame right in the middle. So you can see how those curves control the behavior of your objects. Now, if you don't want to control this manually, if you're one of those folks who just prefers to punch in numbers, you can just select color over life. Here's color over life over in the details panel. Its distribution is a constant curve, which makes sense because we were just editing the curves for it. We can expand the points in that curve, and there's three of them. So one, two, three. And we could take that one in the middle, which is currently, what, it's about 20 and 3.5 and 0.12, and we could set those manually. We could say 20 for X, which is, of course, going to be red in this case. We could set this to a flat 3, and then this to maybe 0.2. So whichever way you want to do that is fine. You'll notice that did update the values over here on the curve as well. Now, you got a lot of controls here over how this works. You have a pan mode, which is just going to allow you to move the view around like you're panning as you drag with the left mouse. You have zoom mode, which is going to allow you to zoom in and out. So left mouse is going to zoom you vertically, right mouse is going to zoom you horizontally. It's just changing the extents of the graph, really, is all you're doing. Then you have the different curve types that you might need, and hopefully you're familiar with these. You have things like auto if you want a nice spliny sort of curve, or linear if you want just a straight linear relationship, or constant if you want something to change the moment that key is actually hit. You can play with the tangents. You can also put curves into tabs as you need to. So I could create a tab. We'll call this my color tab. like so, and I can add curves into it, like these curves here. And then at any point, I could go back to the default tab, which, let's empty out the default tab now. So let's right click and remove all curves, like so. And then it's gonna say, do you wanna do that? We'll say yes. And now if I switch back to my color tab, oh, it actually removed that as well. So let's make sure I add that back in, like so. And over here on default, you can see the difference between the two. So default has nothing in it, and now my color tab has the color. So it's just a way to keep your curves organized if you want to be able to quickly switch between them. So that is Cascade at a glance. I didn't want to spend all day going over each and every single button, because really you're going to get familiar with Cascade as you use it, which is one of my goals. I actually want to push you through some particle effects and make you do some stuff. So that is going to wrap things up for this video. Thanks a lot.